We've got a really great fireside chat next. To help us go through this, we have Wenda Harris Millard, who is the president and COO of MediaLink, and we also have Christy Haubegger, who is the founder of Latino magazine, and we will do that in Portuguese for you.
And as we know, Wenda and Christy are both a great inspiração para nós mulheres que trabalhamos em mídias modern media. Wenda and Christy, welcome. Bem-vindas.
Take it away.
Thank you. So I'm really delighted to be here with you this morning, and we're going to talk about the empowerment of Latina women in this present-day media landscape. My guest today is an industry visionary and an expert on the subject. She was one of the first to give Latina women a face and a voice in media when she launched Latina magazine in 1996, and two decades later continues to champion the participation, progress, and empowerment of Latinas in media in her current role at Creative Artists Agency. Today, she's going to share her insights on how the Latina woman has evolved over the past couple of decades in media and in real life, and how marketers can connect with this increasingly influential consumer population. It's my pleasure to welcome to the stage Christy Haubegger. So Christy,
hi there.
almost 20 years.
Yeah, so try that. Let me read.
I'm with you. So it's been almost 20 years since you launched the magazine, and it's now the leading media vehicle for Hispanic women in the United States. Why did you launch it in the first place?
You know, it's funny. I don't know if many of you were in the media business at the time, but when I was in grad school, after the 1990 census came out, it was supposed to be the decade of the Hispanic, which apparently got rescheduled two times. But now, you know, it's a very interesting thing. But at the time, you know, I was somebody who was a big magazine reader. I mean, I love all kinds of media, but I love magazines. And when I was growing up, I didn't see a lot of positive images of Latinas. You just didn't see it. And even though, you know, I think the census said at the time there were 26 million of us in the United States, we hadn't had our own media yet. So Hispanic media consisted, I mean, print was new media for the Hispanic market, you know, at the time.
Wow.
Yeah, and one of the things that was really, really interesting was to think about how different this population was going to be and how impactful it would be on media.
So how do you think that the portrayal of the Latina woman has changed over these two decades now, or
right.
has it?
Well, you know, it's interesting, you know, after being on the air for decades, you know, you look at Sábado Gigante, right? And the, like, little shaking and all that good stuff. One of the things that I think is very challenging, particularly for brands and marketers, is that there hasn't been a lot of innovation in Hispanic media per se. So if you're a marketer, you know, you still really have two broadcast networks
right.
in the United States. It's kind of like America in the 70s. And the sort of segmentation
right. mm-hmm.
that brands and marketers are accustomed to being able to do in the general market hasn't happened in the Hispanic market in the US to the same extent. And so at the same time, I think as an audience, when we, you know, when we don't connect with what we see on television, we go, you know, head on into social media.
Right, right.
Right, because that's a place where we finally can tell our stories and see our lives reflected.
So how has just sort of sticking with the audience for a moment, and we're certainly gonna talk about brands and marketing, but how has the Latina audience itself responded to any changes in media's depiction
right.
of the Latina woman, or
right.
is it still not resonating?
Well, I think, you know, there's two things that have happened. One is that we are hungry to see ourselves and to see our stories told. And I think you see that when you do see depictions of us. And while we are, you know, 18% of the United States and 23% of the box office, we're still only 4% of speaking characters in movies, right?
Wow.
When you ask Latinos in the US, what percentage of the US do you think is Hispanic? The average answer is 42%. So if you think you're 42% of the population, but you're only 4% of the characters. There's a strange disconnect. And likewise,
pretty large.
Yeah, disconnect. A very big disconnect, you know, 10 times. And the same thing in television. And so I think that what has happened is that most of the Hispanic media in the United States historically has been acquired programming from Latin America, mm-hmm. which is very different than what our lives look like. So for example, most Hispanic women in the United States work outside the home, even with small children. That's not necessarily true in some parts of Latin America, but right. that's the media we're sharing. And so I think that what happens is that when we don't see our stories told or our lives reflected, you know, we're having this great moment now for Latinas that is like the echo of the women's movement that happened, you know, here in the
1970s
and
much,
80s.
Yeah.
So we haven't had our Mary Tyler Moore yet.
right.
You know, I mean, maybe it was Ugly Betty. You know, you sort of have these moments where you realize, oh, we're going to leapfrog forward. But it's early days still. And I think we are still at a very, very early phase. But when we do see ourselves, we get so excited, you know? And I think that's why we connect with our celebrities so intensely.
Well, I was just going to ask you, so if you look at, you know, Sophia and Eva, you know, yeah. just to name yeah. a couple, obviously very, very, very popular. How are they helping with a more yeah. authentic portrayal of the Latina woman?
Well, I think for starters, you know, when I started in this business in the mid-90s, you didn't see women like Eva Longoria or Sofia Vergara or Salma Hayek mm-hmm. in makeup ads. They weren't defined right. as beauty. Mm-hmm. And what's exciting now is that you see Jennifer Lopez.
They're more beautiful than anybody.
Right.
Yeah.
And now mm-hmm. Latina beauty has become American beauty, which also means it becomes global beauty.
That's right.
Because when you see the L'Oreal billboard in Asia and you see our beauty is actually becoming. And so I find that very, you know, it may seem silly, but it actually matters, you know, that somebody acknowledges that we might too be beautiful. And I think that the impact of our celebrities is very interesting. I feel like, you know, my agency represents Jennifer Aniston, right? And we love all of our clients equally, as I'm sure you do. But when we think about the fact that if Jennifer Aniston makes it, I don't know that blonde women everywhere are like, oh gosh, maybe I can make it too. right? I think when Eva Longoria succeeds, I think Latinas are like, wow, I could do this. Mm-hmm. Or when Sophia succeeds or Salma succeeds, like women who are not born in the US who've come here are like, I can make
it. Hold that, yeah.
And so I think there's a relationship that we end up having with our celebrities that's a bit distinct.
So you have, in your role at CAA, mm-hmm. I look at that for you as a wonderful platform mm-hmm. to help move forward this issue. What are the kinds of opportunities that you have to help change the portrayal of Latinas in the media?
I think one thing to keep in mind is that U.S. media, whether Hispanic media or general market media, is global media. And it matters whose stories get told and whose stories we tell, right? There's 7 billion people on the planet. Most of them will never come to the United States, but they will see our movies and our television. And it matters whose stories get told. And if we've never seen a Latina as a superhero, that doesn't mean we're not capable of greatness. And so a lot of what I want to do and what I hope we're doing is by developing a lot of these women in particular, like Sophia and Salma and Eva and America, are all now very accomplished producers, which means that they are choosing the stories they get told. So Eva Longoria has sold 4 shows this season, going into the television development season. All of them have very strong Latina characters at the middle of it. And that, for me, empowering those women on this platform of American television is important. Yes. Now, to be clear, American networks are desperate to reach the Hispanic audience, which is why they go to these women for produced opportunities.
Yeah.
And the reason for that is that if you are an American broadcast network and you're trying to create television that appeals to the, you know, growing audience, you can either focus on, you know, the older audience that is getting smaller, or you can focus on the young, vibrant, diverse audience. And so I think it's a very good time to be who we are right now.
So if you think about the Hispanic community in the U.S., there are many subcultures within the community. And so how should content creators think about addressing that complexity? Because it's not one market.
Right, right. Well, I think one of the things that's really important to understand is that it's really enormously key to understand not only geographic and country of origin differences, but to understand generational differences. So I'm Mexican American, I grew up in Texas. In terms of my media, I have a lot more in common with a Puerto Rican who was raised in New York than I do with a Mexican who just got here from Jalisco, right? Now maybe food-wise, I might have more in common with that person, but in terms of the media I consume, growing up as somebody who's bilingual in this country, I have like the best of both worlds, right? I can watch Spanish and I can watch English, but I had so many more choices in English that I ended up watching more English, right? And so I think that in a way, it's easy to get distracted. There's a lot of people say, well, it's too complicated. I'm just not going to do anything.
Great.
Right? Right. No, but the truth is, if you speak to us, and more importantly, with us, with authenticity, right, real stories. One of the things that I think is remarkable is that now that most of the Hispanics in the United States were born here, it's going to be...
It's a huge
exactly, shift.
Yeah.
Because all of a sudden, it may not be programming, you know, when we think about how to reach us and move us, it won't necessarily be programming for where we're from, but programming for where we are.
The way you live.
The way we live
here,
now.
Right. Yeah.
And that is, you know, we want to have Latino values and American success, right? I want to live with one foot in each culture. And as a result, I'm creating this new culture. And we're impacting the rest of America.
So, you know, one of the things that has been very interesting to watch is the degree to which brands do or do not embrace Latino women. I have a couple of statistics here that are quite fascinating, that in the U.S., Latino women represent more than 50% of all Hispanics matriculating into medical school, and the number of Latina-owned businesses here has increased more than 45% over the past 10 years. So are brands increasing their tailoring their messages to this community, and do you think that their strategies are evolving to leverage it?
Yeah, you know, it's a funny thing. If you look at a lot of traditional advertising and people who are focused on, you know, a 30-second spot, you still see a lot of really, I don't want to say antiquated, but not super contemporary perception.
They're dated.
Yeah, you see, you know, you really see her in the kitchen and she's like, it feels like, 1950s, she's worried about dinner, and you know, it is very, very much focused around she's running the kitchen. And the truth is, a lot of Latinas are running the kitchen
company.
At the restaurant they own.
Exactly.
Or in their catering business, and you haven't seen that woman yet. And you haven't seen her in the scripted content that we see in Spanish language television much yet. And that is a disconnect. I did some work for a brand, one of the biggest CPG brands in the US, and they did a 2-year longitudinal study on Hispanic women in the US, incredibly in-depth ethnographies, and spent a lot of time with these women, and they were all Latinas who had been in this country for more than 10 years. They still largely watched Spanish language television, but the emotional connection wasn't there, because one of them is driving a bus, right? You know, she's got a commercial license and she drives a bus. One of them is literally running a catering business. You know, one of them is got two small children at home and is working, you know, part-time at a retail florist. And none of their lives are seen anywhere in the media. And the CPG marketer realized, I can't deliver a 30-second spot and hope that I'm connecting to her life when the story around that doesn't reflect her life.
And did that marketer change its strategic approach effectively?
Yes, dramatically. And began creating a lot of their own content and utilizing social in a very different way.
And are you seeing more and more of these brands create their own content for that purpose?
Yes. I think that what has happened is the I don't want to say lack of, because there's some innovation, but because the media vehicles that were on offer to marketers in the US didn't keep pace with the level of innovation that was happening in the lives of
It's really, again, the question of consumer behavior.
Yeah, I think it moved marketers faster. You know, because again, if you really only have a couple of broadcast choices, you have to be innovative. You can't even achieve the reach and frequency you would need to.
So what's it going to take to get more marketers to look at this market with sort of the real eye? I mean, are you going to have to run around to every major marketer and work with them
I'm exhausted already. I think that a couple of things are going to happen. One is, I think that if brands spend the time, as they're beginning to do, to really understand the consumer on a multidimensional way, you know, one of these CPG brands that I was talking about realized that to achieve their growth targets, they needed to deliver an incremental $1 billion from Hispanic moms in the next, couple of years.
That should get their attention.
Right. Right. And you were like, oh my gosh, I could buy all the spots in the world and it's not going to do that. I need to get under the hood of this consumer and understand who she is and what moves her and what does she, dream of. And one of the things that I think was very surprising for a lot of brands is how empowered this woman is. How entrepreneurial she is. The fact that Latinas are matriculating into white collar jobs while a lot of the men remain in blue collar. And so it's created this very interesting moment and dynamic in our culture and our community. And if they can look at this consumer and say, I get you, I'm with you in this, you're navigating new territory and you're not alone, I think you could own her.
So we started a little bit to talk about social.
Right.
Tell me about how the Latina woman in this country is using the different channels. And we've talked a lot about television consumption. What about, all things mobile and social?
So, what we've seen so far is that, and I still think it's early days, I do think this internet thing is going to be really big, though.
I think there's something to this.
You can quote me on that. What we see among Latinas in the U.S. and what we've seen among African-American women as well is that these women who have been outsiders in some ways are insiders in social media.
Because they've been given, technology has really given them a voice.
Yes, and, I think one of the things that's kind of remarkable, power is not given, it's taken, right? That's what I learned from Game of Thrones. But these women are seizing their power by creating their networks, and they are participating in higher numbers. I think, first of all, we're just chattier. So I think women, I think that's part of it. But I also know technology is empowering these women in a new way. And what you see is that, for example, in the case of African-American women who dominated Twitter on Wednesday, there were 1.2 million tweets about Empire. There are 2 million Latinos watching Empire this week, which is sort of remarkable on its own. But Latinas tend to prefer Instagram. Instagram is a higher engagement level for Latinas than it is for other women.
That's the kind of thing that I think a marketer should pause on that and understand, that could be huge insight into the behavior of this consumer. Why is that?
Why Instagram? It's interesting to me that I think about, if you think about what each of these media channels is used for, right? So obviously we're enormously engaged on Facebook. But I think actually Instagram, because it's the phone and the picture mm-hmm. and the ability to put the picture up immediately
still
and share
still worth 1,000 words.
It's still worth mm-hmm. 1,000 words. And I think the emotional connection of a photo
with the visual.
With the visual is just so powerful that I think that, you know, I remember years ago when I was selling advertising for Latina, and I remember, two things happened that were really interesting. One was AT&T would find that they thought it was remarkable in some ways because this was sort of early days. Like, yeah, Hispanic women talk to their family every day. You know, like, yes, of course.
Right.
But when it meant long distance, when they were selling long distance, right, that was a big piece of it.
Huge implications for them.
Huge implications for them. And I thought to myself, well, of course, right? So when you think about Instagram, you're like, well, of course.
Right.
Right? Well, of course. The other thing I think is really interesting is things like WhatsApp, right? So mm-hmm. WhatsApp is very, very popular, obviously, everywhere. But I don't know a Mexican who's not on it. And the difference is that when you're in a territory that has a monopoly or a duopoly in terms of wireless providers, and there's not as much competition in the marketplace, unlimited texting is rather expensive. Mm-hmm. But you can use WhatsApp for free.
Right.
Right. And so you see it propels adoption of things like WhatsApp. You know, so there are structural things in place and there are cultural things that enhance. And between the two of those, you see things like our enormously engaged participation on Instagram.
Christy, a last question, because unfortunately our time is closing in. But when you think about, you know, you've done work in this market, yeah. As we said, for 20 years now. What do you wish going forward? What do you wish for the portrayal of the Latina woman in media? What do you wish for marketers?
So I think that, as I said, the stories that we tell matter. And we have this entire generation of young Latinas in this country and in Latin America. And they are going to be the most educated, informed, and connected group. And I think if we acknowledge that and embrace them and frankly reflect them in our storytelling and likewise in our marketing messages, we're going to do some great work. But I think that while we, you know, I don't think people realize how empowered Latinas are. I think there's this unfortunate perception that Latino culture is like macho and patriarchy, but the big secret is that we're actually a matriarchy.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's maybe not a secret.
Yeah.
But the other things, I mean, there are also things like we're very early in racial diversity in Hispanic marketing still, right? So there's still a perceived correlation between race and class. And mm-hmm. so if somebody wants to be aspirational, they show only fair-skinned Latinos. And I think things like that mm-hmm. are changing because, again, you know, something like, if you're not showing me, Instagram will show me. I'll show myself. Mm-hmm. And I think that moment of we're gonna take that power back is an exciting one, but I feel like this is about to be the era of the Latina, and I'm excited for all these empowered young women we're going to see.
Well, I think with you as an ambassador continuing to go forward, you're
Thanks.
In great shape. So
oh, thank you.
Always great to be with you, Christy,
thank you.
And thank you very, very much.
Thank you.
I hope that's a look.
I'll grab a chair.